So, Jesus Christ died on that cross, and Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And he's not ashamed. He's not ashamed of the gospel, because he believes the gospel has the power to save us. Save us from what? Well, the Bible says that God is a holy God. And because God is a holy God, he has to judge. And so the Bible talks about the judgment of God, that one day there's going to be a day of judgment, and that God is going to bring his wrath and judgment. The Bible calls it the wrath of God. It says the wrath of God is revealed against all unrighteousness of men. And the Bible teaches there is a wrath of God, that God is going to judge. I can't judge. It's not my job to judge. But God is a God of judgment, and there is a wrath, a judgment to come. And the Ten Commandments were given by God to show us what is the right way, to show us what is the way. I say, are you okay? Assalamu alaikum. Are you a Muslim? No, do you have a faith? So Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And the gospel is a power to save us. Now, the Bible says that God created the heavens and the universe. The Bible says that God created the heavens and the universe. Genesis chapter 1, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the universe. And then the Bible says that when God created the heavens and the universe, Adam and Eve sinned and rebelled against God. And there was a rebellion. And in this rebellion, Adam and Eve fell, and the human race fell into sin, into rejection of God. And that's why we see all the mess that we see today, all the mess that we see around the world today, is the mess of human condition, rejecting God. That is why we see the mess today around the world. It's because of the fall of man. Man as a fallen being, fallen from the power of God and the grace of God. And man is fallen. Man is in a fallen condition. And no matter how he tries to get back, no matter how much he tries with science, no matter how much he tries with politics, no matter how much he tries, he can never ever break free of the shackles of the sin that he's fallen into. Man is fallen into sin and cannot break free no matter what he does. No matter what he does, he can try politics, he can try philosophy, he can try reason and try to make a utopia, but he'll never make a utopia because man is fallen. Man is fallen. You can try politics, you can try science, you can try philosophy, and man can try and build and build and build. But no matter how much he builds, he is a fallen human being. He is a fallen condition. And man is in a state of fallenness. And that's why we see ISIS all over the place. That's why we see terrorism all over the place. That's why we see corruption all over the place. That's why we see it, because man is in a fallen condition. But God didn't leave it there. God came down in Jesus Christ. In the beginning, God. Do you remember? In the beginning is the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And in the midst of man's fallen condition, God came down to rescue man. God came down to rescue man. By dying on a cross. By dying on a cross. And there on that cross, that was God's rescue mission for humanity. God's rescue mission was to die on that cross. That's God's rescue mission. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes on him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And if you follow politics, it'll take you to hell. If you follow science, it'll take you to hell. If you follow reason, it'll take you to hell. Why? Because man is in bondage. Man is fallen. Man is in a fallen condition, and man is in ruins. And all that man builds, all that man builds in his art and philosophy and science will crumble, because man is fallen. But God didn't leave it there. God came down in Jesus Christ, and God came and died on that cross to redeem us on that cross, to save us from the catastrophe that is here and is coming upon us. And Christ died and took the wrath and the punishment and the judgment for you and me. And there on that cross the Son of God died. And that was God's rescue mission for the world. And it is the rescue mission for you and you and you that Christ died on that cross. And you can live in the ruins of humanity, in the ruins of humanism, in the ruins of philosophy. And you can live in the ruins of politics. But in the midst of the ruins, you can come out of the ashes into the glorious liberty and power of Jesus Christ, where he covers you with his blood, and covers you with his righteousness, and covers you with his cleansing, and covers you with his blood, and saves you, and makes you anew by the blood of Jesus, and sets you free from drugs, sets you free from alcohol, and gives you a new life, new power and hope in the blood of Jesus. For Christ died and rose again and conquered death. And he broke the bonds of death. And death has no sting no more. Death has no power no more. Because Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Isaiah 53, my Jewish friends. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. And if you want to come out of the ruins of humanity, if you want to come out of the ruins of humanism, if you want to come out of the ruins of atheism, and the ruins of religion, and the ruins of mankind, if you want to come out, and you want to come home to God, Christ died on that cross to set you free. He died to set you free, and took your wrath, and took your punishment upon that cross. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes on him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And you can have everlasting life today by believing in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And he is the way, the truth, and the life. And he is the only way to be saved today. God did a rescue mission in Jesus. And the only hope for humanity, the only hope for salvation, is in Christ. That is the only hope, my friends. And if you consistently go with man, if you consistently go with this world, this system will screw you up. This system will eat you up. This system will take you down to the very dregs of hell forever and ever. But if you come to Christ and find in him your salvation, and find in him your hope, and him your strength, and him your power, and him your salvation, then you'll be saved and born again. And not only saved today, but saved out of the ruins of this world, and saved for everlasting life. The devil has a home in hell, and the devil wants to take you to hell. And he's giving you your drugs, he's giving you your sex, he's giving you what you want, and you're playing his game, and you're being taken to hell. And there in hell, you cannot get out. There in hell, you cannot break free. But the devil is playing his tune. The devil is playing his pipes. And you're dancing all the way to hell on the ticket of sex, on the ticket of drugs, on the ticket of gambling. And the devil is playing, and you're going with the devil right to hell. But Jesus broke the power of the devil. And Jesus came and died for you on that cross. And Jesus set you free today. So come and know his love today in your life. Know the love of God in your life. Know the joy of the Lord in your life. Know the power of God. Christ is almighty. Christ is King. He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is above Theresa May. He is above Nicola Sturgeon. He is above the Pope. He is above Richard Dawkins. He is above Mohammed. Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is above Trump. He is above spice. He is above alcohol. He is above drink. His name is Jesus Christ. And Christ can set you free today. Come to him. Don't go with this world and be lost forever and ever and ever in eternity, burning and crying and moaning and screaming, let me out. Let me out. I'm in agony. Let me out. And you'll never get out of hell. You'll never get out of hell. You'll knock and knock and knock and knock. And you'll never ever get out of hell. You'll cry and plead, but you'll never get out of hell. But if you continue to call this way of the world, you will be in hell. And you'll never get out of hell. But Christ shed his blood that you may never go to hell. He shed his blood and went to hell for you. He shed his blood and died for you. He shed his blood and took the wrath for you on that cross. I don't care if you say I'm not politically correct. God ain't politically correct. God ain't politically correct. If you follow political correctness, my friend, I'll see you in hell. Because that's where political correctness will take you. God ain't no politically correct God. God is above political correctness. God is greater than political correctness. Political correctness comes and goes, but God is forever. And his word is forever. And what man says you do not listen to, you listen to what God says. Nicola Sturgeon will go. Theresa May will go. They'll all go. All the movements will go. But God will not go. His word will not go. So my friend, there's only two things to do. Bow the knee to Jesus and find his love in your life. The love of God for you on that cross. The Son of God who died for you on that cross. That's one way to go. The other way to go is stick two fingers up at God, two fingers up at me, and go to hell. It's your choice today. It's your choice. Don't go to hell today. God is a great God. The ruins of humanity is here. Man cannot build on politics. He cannot build on science. He cannot build on philosophy. Mankind is in ruins because mankind has fallen. He has fallen from grace. But God has come to rescue you out of the ruins of humanity by dying on a cross and shedding his blood. I will go home today. If you can defeat me today in argument, come and defeat me right now and prove me wrong. How did something come from nothing? How did the universe come from nothing? Defeat me right now and I'll go home. Defeat me right now and I won't preach. How did the universe come from nothing? Defeat me right now and I won't preach. Defeat me right now and I'll go home. Prove to me, how did the universe come from nothing? It cannot happen. A mind created the universe. You do not get nothing from nothing. All you get from nothing is nothing. God created the universe. God and mind. And you were meant to know God. Not smoke a spliff. Not take spice. Not get drunk. Not catch sexual diseases. You were made to have a relationship with Jesus. You were made to have a relationship with God. Mankind is in ruins. His politics is in ruins. His religion is in ruins. His philosophy is in ruins. Science is in ruins. It's all in ruins. And it's all falling apart. But God had a rescue mission. He came down and died on that cross for you. He died on that cross. Jump on the rescue mission of Jesus and have faith in Him. Trust Him as your Savior. Trust Him as your Savior and your Lord while you can. Trust Him while you can. Have faith in Him while you can. Trust Him while you can. Believe in Him while you can. And find the peace of God. Find the love of God. Find the joy of Jesus. Find the power of God in Him. Find God in your life. The life of God. The joy of the Lord. Find Him today while you can. And don't drink the dregs of mankind. Don't drink the dregs of the devil. They want to delude you with drugs and delude you with sex and delude you with gambling and delude you with spice and delude you with porn. He wants to delude you and take you to hell. Don't listen to his deception. Shake it off and come to the Word of God. That will set you free, the power of His Word. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. For it is the power of God unto salvation. The power of God to change you. The power of God to set you free. You want to set free today? Christ will set you free. He will change you and give you a life. He will set you free today. Jesus will set you free. He is the Savior today. The same today, yesterday, and forever. He will change you. Have you got any questions, bro? Any arguments, questions? Are you an atheist? Any reasons why you're an atheist? Explain to me. Explain to me as an atheist how something came from nothing. Go for it, bro. I'll do that, but you tell me how something came from nothing. Go on, bro. If you do, I'll become an atheist right now. Whoops. I'll become an atheist right now if you tell me how something came from nothing. You can't explain it. There's the atheist for you. Respect, mate. I respect you, yeah? But you can't give the argument. How can something come from nothing? Come on, bro. And you can't do it, you see? You can't explain it. You can't explain it. The atheist couldn't explain how something came from nothing. Doesn't make sense. Jesus Christ created this world and He came and died for you on this cross, on the cross. And He wants to set you free today. Have faith in Him. I like that smile. She's got a good smile. Jesus Christ died on that cross to set you free today. Remember, He came to set you free. Look to Him today. Amen. That's a good question. He's asked me. I asked the atheist how something can come from nothing, and nothing cannot come from something cannot come from nothing. Yeah. So we're either going to go with science, or we're going to have a supernatural explanation. Yeah. Right. Are you listening? Listening. Now, when I look at the universe and I see something, I see order. I see a mind. I see you've got a mind. I've got a mind. So when something came from nothing, it can only be a mind that produced the something from nothing. Would you agree? Would you agree? How do you get mind from nothing? If there's nothing, how do we get a mind from nothing? Okay, I respect what you're saying. You're saying it's a slow process, yeah? I understand what you're saying. It's a good point. You're saying you're assuming you're not taking into consideration over time a mind can develop. But here's the point: there was nothing in the universe, right? There's nothing in the universe where you have a mind. So how can nothing produce mind? Logic tells you mind produces mind. So when there was nothing, there must have been a mind before the nothing, which is God, that produced the nothing to be something, which was mind. So you have mind plus mind equals mind. You've got nothing plus nothing equals mind. Does it work? Well, by definition, creation means physical. If I say who created this or that, it means physical. But God, by definition, is not physical. By definition, He's eternal. But my friend, I really respect you because it takes a lot of courage for you to stand there, bro. It takes a lot of courage. So if you want to engage, yeah? I can, in this case, if I can. If I say, what's that made of? There's sugar in that, yeah? Right. So by definition, that sweet has sugar. Yeah? That's in its character, in its nature, explains itself. Sugar, sweet, yeah? When I say God, by definition, is eternal. That's the explanation. So when you say it doesn't explain anything, I'm saying by the very nature of God, He is eternal. That explains it. Just like by the very nature of that sweet, it's sugar. You can push it back and say, well, it's made of not just sugar, other stuff, but at the end of the day, you're just playing semantics there. Yeah? God, by definition, is eternal. Here's a question. Do you believe Jesus Christ existed? All right. Are you an atheist? Are you an atheist? What? Guys, are you an atheist? No. Are you an agnostic? What is your position? In a debate, it's fair for the person to say what their position is. So what is your position? My position is, I'm a born again Christian. Honest, above board, that's what I am. What's your position? Okay, are you an agnostic? Okay, so do you believe Jesus existed? You don't believe Jesus existed? You don't believe He existed? What evidence do you have for that statement? Well, I could say there's cheese on the moon, and if I make that statement, I've got to prove it. You say that Jesus didn't exist, you have to prove it. I'm going to give you the evidence for my position, but you've got to give your evidence for your position. It is. Yeah. No, my friend, we're in a debate. This is a debate. It's not a monologue. It's not me just preaching. It's a rational discussion and debate, right? And in rational discussion and debate, each person has to provide evidence. Your position has to have evidence or it's not rational. My position has to have evidence. It's not just fair for me to produce evidence, because what you're doing then is you're putting the bar too high for me. You're saying, I've got to prove it, but you don't have to do anything. That's not the case. You've got to provide evidence as well, yeah? Right, so I'll give you evidence for Jesus existing, and you give me evidence that He didn't exist. You're saying He didn't exist. I'll give you evidence He existed. Josephus, a Jewish historian who lived in the area of Jesus, not so long after Jesus, said Jesus died under Pontius Pilate. Tacitus, a Roman historian who lived near the time of Jesus, said that Jesus died under Pontius Pilate. Now, in scholarship, when you have your enemies say something about you, it's probably true. So, Jesus probably existed just on the basis of Tacitus and Josephus. Now, that's evidence outside the Bible. Wait a minute. Now you provide evidence that Jesus did not exist. You've made that proposition. Now you make the evidence. I've given you the best scholarship in the world today from people who are not Christians who would agree with me, even non-Christian scholars would agree with me that Jesus died on the cross. Dominic Crossan, who's a world authority, who's a skeptic, doesn't agree with what I believe, says that Jesus dying on the cross is one of the most well-attested facts in ancient history. Now you made the proposition that Jesus did not exist. Over to you, sir. Thank you. You made some good points there. The point that I asked you though, we were having a debate about did Jesus exist, right? Wait a minute. Let me just finish with this person. We were talking about Jesus exists. You've acknowledged that, won't you? You'd be intellectually honest, yeah? And I gave you evidence for Jesus existing. Wait a minute. I give you historical evidence that Jesus exists, yeah? Okay, my friend, we're talking about history. Now you can go to ancient documents, you can go and read Josephus, you can go and read the history of the Jews by Josephus, you can go and read the history of Rome by Tacitus. I'm telling you scholarship that most scholars would agree with, and you can go and study the evidence, right? Now, we've given you the historical evidence for Jesus, you've not counted that, but you went on to other stuff, and you made some good points, so let's go to those other stuff, but you did equivocate, you did move from the topic. You said, why did God come to a little bit of the world in Israel? If you read Romans chapter 1, let me finish, right? Yeah. Romans chapter 1 says that everybody knows there's a God in two ways. All right, mate. God says in Romans chapter 1, that all of us know there's a God because of creation. So you're saying, well, why did God... All right. What was that? All right. My friend, what I'm saying is, God says by his creation, that speaks of God, right? So you're saying, why did he go to a little land and he not spoke to everybody else? But he's saying that even creation speaks of a God. You can see there is order in this creation. There's order in that tree. Who's following the set of instructions, bro? Well, that counters your argument, because if there's only one way, it shows that it was created. For example, chance producing a universe that is only one way isn't logical. Chance has multiple options, yeah? The fact that the universe is ordered in that if this Earth was a few miles nearer to the Sun, we'd burn. If it was a few miles away from the Sun, we'd freeze, yeah? So the Earth is in the right place at the right time. That should make you think that that's a mind behind that, not chance, yeah? So are you open-minded? Okay. If you're open-minded, do you believe that miracles have happened? No. There was an atheist called David Hume, a philosopher, yeah? And he was open-minded to miracles, and he investigated miracles that happened 100 years before him. And he had 5 criteria for these miracles. The people had to be intelligent, they had to be this, that, and the other, yeah? He investigated these miracles that happened in the time of the 16th century in Catholic France, right? When he investigated it with his 5 criteria, he said, according to my 5 criteria, that they've got to be educated, honest, etc. He said, according to my 5 criteria, these miracles happened. But guess what he said then? He said, but the miracles didn't happen because miracles don't happen. In other words, he's saying that even though the evidence is there, he's not going to believe it because he doesn't see it happening in nature himself, yeah? Now here's the point, at least he was honest and had a 5 criteria. If you're saying miracles have never happened, what criteria do you have when you're reading the Gospels to say that the Gospels never had any miracles? What's your criteria? I understand what you're saying. That's a good. That is. See that you obviously have done some study or thought on this kind of stuff. Yeah.
But what you were saying about the just one stop there.
Yeah.
You know, you said a few miles that way, a few miles the other way.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you think about that in the Milky Way galaxy, there are 200 million stars.
Yeah. Yeah.
And like I said, a little deep here, which is one set of space.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
Trillions of galaxies.
Yeah.
Is it not beyond the realms of possibility? Just happened by chance.
Okay.
Written by, you know, out of the trillions.
Define chance.
Chance.
What would you say chance?
So even.
What? Just. But the thing is, I don't want to put you on the spot because it'd be extremely difficult to define. But just give me a rough idea of what you think.
Chance is the possibility.
An evolutionist called Dr. Monod, who was a Nobel Prize winner in evolution in the 1960s, and he said about, I know it's a different subject, I don't want to equivocate, but it has an interesting this, yeah? He said that evolution was chance. Now, evolutionists today would not agree with that. They would disagree with him. They would say that mutations and natural selection, that's not fully chance, yeah? Right, but he was honest and said evolution by chance, but he realized that if it is by chance, it just, statistically, it doesn't add up. Statistically, you know. And there was a conference in the 1960s where mathematicians came to the evolutionists. They weren't Christians or creationists or they were evolutionists, and they did statistical analysis of evolution, and they said it's just impossible. So you can have infinity to play with, but when you're playing with infinity, you're not playing with mind, you're playing with matter, right? And our position is we're playing with mind, and we're saying that mind is behind the universe. Mind produced all this. What you're saying is we've got infinity and chance. And all I'm saying to you, right, even if I granted your position of infinity, my position, I believe, is more logical to say, well, I believe it was a mind, because mind can produce logic. Mind can produce order. Wait a minute, mind can produce regular pattern. And I find in your DNA regular pattern. I find in your brain logic, right? Whereas if you have infinity and chance, I would say that it doesn't make logical sense, personally, that that could produce regular patterns. Not just one pattern, but regular patterns. Do you see what I mean? Regular, it's like winning the lottery every day with your position. Do you understand what I'm getting at?
So with evolution, statistically, it can happen the way it does. The chance doesn't play a role in it, actually. You know, say something evolves into something that works out in the desert, and then an ice age comes along, it doesn't matter, it's a dead species. Not its chance. But also what you're forgetting is this is just, have you ever heard Carl Sagan of Bill?
Yeah.
He says we are just an infinitesimal speck, suspended in space. So if you can really imagine that, you can define civilization, recognize the features of the universe. It's just because we feel it from the human perspective. Logic is in it, in my mind, in my mind. And I think that's the thing that universe is beautiful. It's this very special thing that's just come out.
words that you're using, they're just words. They've not got any context. Can I come back? Because I'll come back to you. Let me come back to you. The words that you're using, they're just words. There's no content. Now let me explain. You're saying that there could be another universe somewhere with using a logic that's completely different from ours, right? Well, I'm working on from what we know, not what we don't know. Wait a minute, let me just finish. When you were talking about logic over there, that same as here, I'm saying that I'm working from what we know, you have a mind, I have a mind. Let me finish. No, I'm working from what I see now, in you, in me. You've got a mind, I've got a mind. I see patterns in you, there's patterns in me. You've got DNA, I've got DNA. So I'm working from that now, alright? So what I'm saying is your first point that you were saying, and be intellectually honest, and it's not about winning arguments, it's just about looking at each other's position and point of view, yeah? But you said that there could be another logic, another way of looking at it, right? And I'm saying my position is I'm looking from what I know, yours is on that issue of assumption, right? Second thing is, logic is a good way of thinking about the existence of God. Right, because in logic we reason and we look at nature and we understand things and we compute things. And if logic is material, it's a material thing, then it changes. If logic's immaterial, is it? Are you sure about that? Am I wrong if I disagreed with you?
No, I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm saying it's
not. Are you right about that? So you're not right. So you're not making sense. What I'm saying is you cannot get out of the loop of using objective logic. I don't know who did that. What I'm trying to show you there, boys, you can't get jobs. It's all right to say your logic is different from mine, but you're using what is called the law of non-contradiction when you're talking, the basic law of logic, yeah? When you're talking there. And you had to use it in order to make the statement. That's all I was saying. So it's not whether you think or I think, you were invoking a law outside of yourself. So do you get what I'm saying? No, we need logic. You can't debate without logic. And what I'm saying is logic is, I would say, is immaterial. If it's material, it changes. If it changes, it's your position's correct. If logic is material, it changes, and your position is right, everybody's logic's the same. Let me just finish, right? But you had to invoke a general law of logic showing you it's not just physical, it's outside of yourself. So what I'm saying is, it's immaterial. Now that would fit better with the God who created the universe. A mind that's immaterial creates logic that's immaterial. But if you're a scientific materialist, say all that we know is the material, and logic's material, and logic changes, means your position is right, that anybody's view is okay. But if my view's right, it means that we can have right and wrong in argument because of this idea of logic's immaterial. All I've given you there, it's a sophisticated, it's called the transcendental argument. It's just a simple but sophisticated argument for the defense of God on logic. Alright? I've read Nietzsche. Can I come in about Nietzsche? I admire you, I respect you, and I think if we had a coffee, we'd have some great conversations, and both of you, right? Nietzsche said, if you remember, he said that all this Christianity is all weak stuff, we've got to be strong, put it aside. But near the end of his life, we don't want to be showing this wishy-washy love that these Christians do, we've got to be strong. Yeah, yeah. But do you know, can I just come back to that? Do you know what happened at the end of his life?
Did he find religion?
No. At the end of his life, he saw a horse being beaten mercilessly by his master. And he went and did something against his own philosophy. He went and hocked the horse and showed love to the horse, stopped the beating and like, wait a minute. Yeah, no, but if you read his philosophy, if you study his philosophy, it's quite clear about Nietzsche that love was not at the heart of Nietzsche, that power was at the heart of it. Power and will was at the heart of Nietzsche. And it was about will to power, if you remember. It's about, if you have a will, you can have power. It was not about love. And his criticism of Christianity was, it was about love and it was all weak and wishy-washy. But when he hugged the horse, you know Christopher Hitchens? He mentions this near the end of his life as well. He showed love, contradicting his own system. It wasn't will to power, it was love. And all I'm saying to you, my friend, is Christ died for you on that cross, shed his blood for you. And if you want to know God, if you want to be in relationship with God, it's understanding that Christ died on that cross for you. You're saying a lot though, you made a lot of statements, and some of those statements are true, that leaders can impose views on people. Yeah, but I'm just saying that some of the things that you're saying are true to a certain extent, but then there are some things that are not true what you're saying. For example, Christianity, the first 300 years of Christianity, there were regular persecutions. You know, what's his name? Nero, yeah? There were people like Nero. So Christianity was, people were being slaughtered. Irenaeus, let me just finish. I listen to you with respect. You just listen to me, just respect. Because I listen to you, yeah? And I engage with you and I enjoy what you're saying. Yeah? I'm just saying, there was a guy called Irenaeus who was an early church father, and he was a catechumen. He did teaching, wasn't a bishop. And he was told to go to Rome. And he went to Rome to talk to the emperor and whatever, because Christians were being persecuted. While in somewhere in France, in Gaul at the time, while in the city where he was, the Gnostics said that the Christians were killing babies. So the Roman soldiers marched into the city, slaughtered everybody. They got Christians in iron chairs and set them alight to burn in heat. They even crushed the bones and threw them into the river and fed the bits to the dogs. So when Irenaeus came back, the Christian church was decimated, the bishop had been killed, he became a bishop, they made him a bishop, he stayed and preached. Now it was that courage of him standing there and preaching that made Christianity spread for 300 years. That's the kind of persecution they experienced. So it didn't come about by a political leader. It came about by Christians believing and standing for the faith in persecution. Second thing is, you said about all religions, what makes Christianity different from other religions? Well, one of them is evidence. evidence. The Quran says Jesus didn't die on a cross. The Bible says he did. Put the Bible aside, put the Quran aside, can we discern, did Jesus die on a cross? We can. We can. Josephus, no, there, my friend, honestly, there is. You want to go and study? Josephus, a Jewish historian, 30, 40 years after Jesus, said he died under Pontius Pilate. Tacitus, a Roman historian, said he died under Pontius Pilate. These people, wait, my friend, this is honest scholarship. It's not, we're talking about enemies against Christianity. All right, they were against Christianity. Yeah, that's why we have multiple evidence. That's why I didn't just go to the Bible, but I went outside the Bible. I went to enemies. I can't go to the Bible, because eyewitnesses material in the Bible. And if you put that, and then you put enemies, it's called multiple attestation. And when you get multiple attestation, it's not required. That's why what you're saying is true. You've got to check and check and check. So the more checks you've got, the more it's verified. So there's loads of checks that Jesus died, so there's evidence. So here's the point. The Quran says he did not die. Who are you going to believe? Muhammad 600 years later, who didn't know Jesus, or Josephus, who Tacitus, who hated the Christians, and said Jesus died in the Pontius Pilate? It's a no-brainer. Is that a fair point? Mm-hmm. Right, okay. Yeah. Yeah, but my friend, you're a nice guy and I respect you. But the proposition that you made, and my friend made it, the first proposition you made and he made, is Jesus didn't probably exist. And I've just given you the proposition that he did, and then I undergirded it with evidence. Now we're moving on to, is Jesus the Son of God? But I built a platform that he did exist. Yeah, right. So now my friend, you are a smart guy, you're a nice guy. All I'm asking you to do is go honestly investigate. You're reading Nietzsche. Go and read C.S. Lewis as well. Have you heard of Francis Schaeffer? Go and read some Francis Schaeffer. If you like that kind of stuff, read Francis Schaeffer. Yeah? And investigate a bit more on the Christian side as well as that side. Alright. Alright, God bless you. Take care, man. Alright, take care. See you, man.
Jason?
Yeah?
So, we forgot to mention,